Hi, today we are going to learn about bioavailability and bioequivalence. I'll be teaching you this particular chapter in a series of videos. Okay, for that you need to subscribe my channel. So let's start with this. What is bioavailability and bioequivalence? I'll directly take the screenshot of the textbook and I will teach you from that textbook screenshot only. Okay, so that it won't confuse you saying that, okay, textbook it is written like this, I am saying something else. Okay, to avoid that, I will be taking this screenshot of textbooks and I will be teaching you this particular topic. So to start with, what this thing says, it says, see here, the therapeutic effectiveness of a drug depends upon ability of dosage form to deliver the medicaments at the site of action. So at a rate and amount sufficient to elicit desired pharmacological response. So what do you mean by this? So let's say you have given one dosage form, let's say that dosage form is tablet. So if I give the tablet, the drug which is present in the tablet to show its therapeutic effect, okay, or to show its therapeutic effectiveness, it all depends on the ability of this tablet, this particular tablet, okay, to deliver the drug at the site of action. So this tablet will deliver the drug at the site of action, then this drug will show the action and at what rate it is delivering, the rate of delivery and amount sufficient to elicit the therapeutic action. That what this point is saying. What this point is saying is, to get the therapeutic effectiveness, the factors which is dependent is the amount of drug which is going to come out from the dosage form to the site of action at a particular rate and at sufficient amount to show the therapeutic action. For this, this attribute of dosage form is referred as physiological ability. So this property of dosage form which is delivering the drug at specific site at specific rate in specific amount, we call that as physiological availability, or you can say biological availability or simply bioavailability. So what do you mean by that? So you have a dosage form, let's say tablet. From the tablet the drug is coming and entering into the site of action of application of your dosage form. Let's say if it is a tablet, we'll take it orally, from oral to the systemic circulation and till it shows the action. So this ability of a tablet to show the action, in between what all we have, the rate of release and the amount of drug released, okay, all this together, all these tablet attributes or dosage form attribute together, we call it as physiological availability, biological availability, or simply you can say it as bioavailability. Okay, so for the most of the drugs, pharmacological response can be directly related to the plasma levels. So we know that, okay, we have drug plasma levels like this. Okay, the plasma level is within the therapeutic window, then only we will get the pharmacological response. That's what this point is saying. So for most of the drugs, your pharmacological response can be directly related to plasma levels. Thus, the term bioavailability is defined as, so now we'll see the, till now we saw what is the introduction for that bioavailability. What is that introduction? You have a dosage form, it will deliver the drug in some rate, in some amount at the site of application. From there, the drug will enter and give the pharmacological action. We call that as a bioavailability, or you can say physiological availability. But for many drugs, what we found is, if the concentration of plasma is good, then only the therapeutic effect is attained. Means plasma concentration and therapeutic effect both are correlated. Okay, by taking this introduction, we try to frame a definition for what is bioavailability. So what the definition says, the term bioavailability is defined as rate and extent. I just said you, the introduction, you given a dosage form, in which rate the drug is releasing and what extent the drug is releasing. So the rate and extent. Extent means amount. What is the amount of drug reaching to the particular action site? Of drug absorption in unchanged form. Remember, the rate and extent of drug absorption in the unchanged form. The drug should not change. Why I am calling this specifically unchanged form is, okay, why I am calling specifically unchanged form is, let's say this is a GIT, okay, you give a drug orally, one tablet. So from the tablet, drug will be disintegrate, then dissolute, it will release. Then before going into systemic circulation, first it will go to the liver. It will get metabolized. Some part of the drug is being metabolized. So in this process, the drug is releasing from the dosage form. Okay. Then drug is absorbing, drug is metabolizing. In all this process, whatever the drug you have given, let's say the drug given is paracetamol. So the paracetamol should be paracetamol only. It should not change. It's chemical nature, that what the definition says, in its unchanged drug form. It should not change the form, any form, chemical form, physical form, anything. It should not change the, okay, from its dosage form. It should not change its any form from the dosage form. We call it as bioavailability. So to repeat this, what we call that, the definition says is the rate and extent. Rate means what is the amount of drug entering per given time. Extent, how much amount is entered into the systemic circulation for given time. The rate and extent of the drug absorption in its unchanged form. So it should not change. From what? From the given dosage form. We call it as a bioavailability. So bioavailability is an absolute term. The rate or rapidity with which, see here, the rate or rapidity with which a drug is absorbed is an important consideration when rapid action is desired. So when you want the action should be very quick, at that time the rate and rapidity of the drug absorption is very, very important. That what we are going to find out in bioavailability, the rate and rapidity. In other case, the slower absorption is desired when you want the prolonged duration of action. Let's say if I given this one, if you want prolonged duration of action should be so long. In such case, you want the drug to be absorbed very slowly. If the onset of action, if you require very fast, in such case, you want the drug absorption and rate and extent of absorption should be very fast. So where you want fast absorption, see here, asthma attack, pain. Let's say I have a pain now, if I take drug, the drug will act after 5 hours or 6 hours, then no meaning of taking the drug, okay. So if I have pain now, if I take dosage form, that dosage form should act now itself. So at that case, I want that to be fast acting. In such case, the rate and extent of absorption is very, very important. We need slower action also, where in case to avoid the adverse effects. Some tablets, if they absorb very fastly, they show some adverse effects. To avoid those adverse effects, we need slower action or slower duration of absorption also. On other hand, we have, see here, the extent of absorption is specially significant. What is that? Extent of absorption is special significance in treatment of chronic conditions like hypertension and epilepsy. What do you mean by that is, in epilepsy and hypertension, I want the drug to be keep on absorbing like this. It should be in the therapeutic range for longer period of time, because if the drug concentration decreases below therapeutic level, it will cause hypertension. So to avoid this, I want my drug to be in the therapeutic level only for a prolonged period of time. So that what this introduction is saying. So the next part is, if the size of the dosage administered is same, let's say I am taking 500 mg of some drug, okay, then bioavailability of drug from each dosage form depends on three major factors. What he is saying is, if the size of administered dosage is same, let's say I am taking here liquid dosage form, I am taking here solid dosage form, but the size of dose administered is same, that is 500 mg. In that case, the bioavailability is depended on three factors. If you administer the same drug, okay, same size of drug in different dosage form, the bioavailability will depend on the three factors. What are those three factors? Is pharmaceutical factor related to, one is pharmaceutical factor. What is that pharmaceutical factor? Which is related to physiochemical properties of drug. What do you mean by physiochemical properties? Drug is soluble, drug is crystalline or amorphous. If at all it is crystalline, which crystalline lattice, and whether that crystalline lattice is metastable or stable. All this property comes under physiochemical property of drug. So the pharmaceutical factor, one is physiochemical property of drug, two is characteristics of dosage form. What are the characteristics of dosage form? Whether it is a swelling or whether it is solubilizing, we don't know. What is the characteristics of your dosage form? That is your pharmaceutical factor. So the bioavailability is dependent on three factors. If the administered dose is same in two different dosage form, those dependent factors, three dependent factors are, one is pharmaceutical factor, which is again subdivided into two, physiochemical property of drug and characteristics of dosage form. Two, patient related factors. So we have many factors related to patient. If what is the disease condition, what, how the patient is taking the food, everything, it will come under a patient related factor. They also affect your bioavailability. If the drug is let's say water soluble and you had a fat meal, in that case the absorption of the drug will be decreased. So patient related factor, or he has some ulcers or something problem in the GIT, then the absorption is decreased. If at all I am applying into the skin, if he has problem on the skin surface when I am applying drug here, then also it will cause absorption of the drug. So in turn, this absorption, which is been a problem, will cause problem in bioavailability also. That what the dependent factor related to patient. Then route of administration. Obviously, if we give through IV, the absorption will be 100%. No absorption then. Directly you are giving to the blood circulation. Hence the bioavailability will be 100%. And so on. We have, like this, we have for a tablet, which is other routes we have, like say skin on the skin or orally, etc. Okay, we through other routes the absorption or the bioavailability will be less compared to the IV route. That what this route of administration is saying. So this topic is saying the former two factors, that is your pharmaceutical factor and patient related factor, is explained in chapter 2. So we'll deal this in later stages when I'm telling that chapter 2, because I am dealing this chapter now. I will be explaining here the influence of route of administration is explained. What he is explaining is parenteral route is much more absorbed than oral, than rectal, than topical. Okay, so in the intravenous injection, we have 100% of bioavailability because it bypasses the absorption process. You are giving directly into the blood circulation. Hence, this intravenous route will bypass your bioavailability. Next, then, however, for reasons of stability and convenience, most of the drugs are administered orally. You can ask me, sir, if the bioavailability is 100%, why can't we give all drugs in IV route only? Okay, because IV, you need one person to inject. Specialized person. Okay, every time you can't have that specialized person in your home. Okay, you need to take that drug every day or thrice a day. Then you need to go and have to inject that drug. So that what is convenience. For the sake of convenience and reasons of stability. Stability in the sense, let's say in the IV, the drug should be in soluble form. Most of the drugs will be in soluble form in IV. If you are using a liquid, there is a chance that the drug will undergo hydrolysis. So there will be a stability problem if I am giving the drug in liquid form. Compared to solid, liquid dosage forms are more susceptible for drug degradation compared to solid dosage form. Okay, in such case, Because orally administered drug is given more preference than IV due to stability and convenience issues, the dose available to the patient we call it as bioavailable dose. Okay. If you given the orally drug, from the oral the drug will be absorbed and some part of the dose is been available to the patient, that is entered into the systemic circulation. That amount of drug which is entered into the systemic circulation, we call it as bioavailable dose. So this dose is often less than administered dose. Obviously, if it is oral route, the administered dose, the absorbed dose will be less than administered dose. Okay, absorbed dose will be less than your administered dose. So the amount of drug that reaches to the CL, the amount of drug that reaches to the systemic circulation is called systemic availability or simply availability. So if you are given drug through oral route, so previously what we saw, if you give through IV route, the drug absorption is 100% because there is a convenience in oral route and stability issues are there in IV route. To avoid this, we give the drug in especially the preferred route is oral route. If you come to the oral route, the given drug or the available drug for the patient is much more less, or it will be always less than the drug which is been administered. So the drug which is available for the patient, or the drug which reaches to the systemic circulation, okay, the amount of drug which reaches to the systemic circulation, we call it as systemic availability or simply availability. So there is a other term, there is a confusion between students about bioavailability and bioavailable fraction. If I say bioavailability, remember bioavailability is the rate and extent. If we say bioavailable fraction, then you have to write this equation. Okay, remember this. So we can in a flow we call this also, this equation also as a bioavailability equation, but the bioavailability is the rate and extent of drug absorption, and your bioavailable fraction, what is that bioavailable fraction, we'll try to see this. Bioavailable fraction, the name says fraction, some means dividend here. What do you mean by that? Refers to the fraction of drug administered, or you can say fraction of administered dose that enters the systemic circulation. How to know this? If you denote it by F, if you want to divide how much dose is available, that is bioavailable dose divided by administered dose. So let's say you are given 500 mg. Among this 500 mg, 350 is absorbed. Yeah, just wait. Among this 500 mg, 350 mg is absorbed. What is the given 500 mg? This fraction we call it as bioavailable fraction. See here, yeah, this fraction we call it as bioavailable fraction. Two terms are there, bioavailability, rate and extent. Bioavailable fraction means you are going to do the fraction of how much drug entered into the body divided by total drug given. Then we will see what are the objective, why we are studying this bioavailability as a chapter. What is the objective of conducting? There are whole study which is been conducted compared to the bioavailability. So why, what are the objectives of bioavailability studies? We will see what is that objective. The first objective is, see here, primary stage of development of suitable dosage form for a new drug entity. What this point is saying is, let's say you have new drug in your hand, you have a new drug, okay, after synthesizing a drug, so many drugs we will synthesize, then we will narrow down to only one drug through chemical trials, clinical trials, that this everything. After all this, those people will come to the pharmaceutics person and they will ask that pharmaceutics person to design a new drug delivery system for that delivery system for the new drug. So while designing that delivery system, what is the suitable dosage form for the particular drug? Okay, let's say if the drug is very soluble, or if the drug is having some physiochemical property issues or if the drug is having some properties. Depending on the drug characteristics, I will design what is the suitable suitable dosage form, whether I have to give this drug in liquid dosage form, whether I have to give this drug in solid dosage form. New drug is there, you need to decide the dosage form. In such case, what I will do is I will convert this drug into a, let's say, solid dosage form, let's say tablet. If I assume that okay, I have cross checked all the properties, there is no issue with the drug and the polymers use, everything is good, but I want to know whether the drug is performing good or not, what I will do, I will take that newly developed dosage form, that is tablet, for that new drug, and I will give to the patient. If I give to the patient, if I conduct the bioavailability study, I will get clear conclusion that okay, the particular dosage form is good or not. Like this, I will take capsule, I will take liquid dosage form, I will take solid dosage form, etc., semi-solid, etc. Okay, I will design the drug in 2 to 3 dosage form, I will give to the different patient, I will conduct bioavailability study, I will check the rate and extent. Wherever the rate and extent of the drug is very good, that particular dosage form is been finalized. The rate and extent of drug availability is good in solid dosage form, we will finalize that. Okay, solid dosage form is the best dosage form for this new drug entity. That what this primary stage of development of new drug is saying, that first point is saying. Second point is determination of influence of excipients, patient related factors and possible interactions with other drugs on efficacy of absorption. So, we will see part by part. This particular point includes 3 points. One is influence of excipients. So, I want to know, let's say I am using some excipient in a particular dosage form. So, what is the influence of that excipient? Whether this excipient is hindering the drug absorption, release of the drug, or if the drug particular excipient is helping the drug to reach systemic circulation, or if particular excipient is helping the drug to get solubilized. I don't know that. To know what is the effect of excipient on drug absorption, we conduct bioavailability study. One. Second point in this same point is patient related factors. So, related to patient, let's say my dosage form is good, my drug is good, everything is good, I designed a good dosage form. I want to know what is, if I give to any one patient, there the drug absorption is not proper. I want to know what is the reason there. So, to know what is the patient related factors for the drug absorption, I need to conduct bioavailability studies. The third point is interaction with other drugs. Let's say I am giving 2 drugs together. One drug is hindering the absorption of other drug. The best example which I can give for this is tetracycline. It is an antibiotic. When you take this antibiotic with milk products where we have calcium in that, this calcium will go and form a complex with the tetracycline and it will hinder the absorption of tetracycline. How can I find this? This is what happening there. How the scientists find out this? By conducting bioavailability studies. They give the tetracycline to the patient. They make that patient to drink milk or some calcium containing substance. If at all there is a no absorption, then they will try to see that okay, this drug is forming complex, hence there is no absorption. So that what is your patient related factors for drug absorption. The third point says development of new formulation for existing drug. Let's say already I have a tablet, drug in tablet dosage form. I want to develop the drug in semi-solid dosage form, something. Okay. Then what happened? Because I am going to develop the drug in new dosage form, I am using new excipients there. I want to know what is the effect of those excipients, or you can say that dosage form, on the drug absorption. In that case also, I will conduct bioavailability studies. The third point is quality, control of quality of a drug product during early stages of marketing in order to determine the influence of processing factors, storage, stability. So, I want to know, I want to control the quality of the drug. Okay. So, in the initial studies, still the drug is not released into the market, but I want to know what are the factors which are affecting the quality of the drug. Quality of the drug means what? In terms, when I give the drug, let's say one processing factors. Let's say I am using some processing factor. I am mixing in something, I am heating there. what is that processing factor is having effect on drug absorption, or you can say stability of the, or you can say quality control of the drug. To know that, I need to conduct bioavailability study also. To storage, what is the effect of storage conditions on the drug absorption, or you can say on the drug bioavailability. You can answer how this effect. See, if you store the drug, if the storage condition is not proper, what happens? There is a chance that the drug may interact with the polymer which is present due to that temperature, higher temperature. Higher temperature, more activation energy, the drug will be reacting with the polymers, or you can say drug will get degraded itself. The degraded product will react with the polymer, form some complex which in turn affect my drug absorption. To know that effect also, I need to conduct bioavailability studies. And finally, stability. How stable is my drug? To know that also, I need to conduct the bioavailability study. If the drug is not stable, stable in the sense, let's say the drug is degrading in acidic pH. I don't know that the drug is going to degrade in acidic pH. I have given the drug. Now, I am waiting. I have given the tablet to the patient. I am waiting that, okay, there will be a response. There is no response. Why? Reason, the drug is getting degraded in acidic pH. Because the drug is getting degraded, there is less drug which is absorbed into the systemic circulation, and there will be no therapeutic effect to the patient. To know this effect also, I need to conduct bioavailability studies. Next, what are the considerations in bioavailability study design? So, let's say I am conducting bioavailability study now. So, to design this study, what are the things I need to consider? Okay. For that, I need to have bioavailability RF divided into two types, that is absolute bioavailability and relative bioavailability. What do you mean by this is, to conduct bioavailability studies, what are the things you need to consider during designing the bioavailability study? How will you design? How will you conduct? How will you see the bioavailability study? So, you are going to give a drug, one tablet, and you will check how much I have given and how much is absorbed. Not like that. So, there is a particular study design for that. For that, we have two topics, that is absolute bioavailability versus relative bioavailability. You can conduct the study in the form of absolute bioavailability. You can conduct the bioavailability studies in the form of relative bioavailability studies also. What is this absolute? What is this relative? We will see in the later stage. So, when the systemic availability of drug administered orally is determined in comparison to its intravenous administration. We are going to see what is absolute bioavailability, definition for absolute bioavailability. So, what do you mean by absolute bioavailability? When the systemic availability of drug administered orally, let's say I have administered one drug, let's say I have a dosage form, I administered this dosage form orally. Okay, and I will measure how much drug is available in systemic circulation. How much drug is available? XMG is available. When this XMG of drug which is available when it is given orally is compared, okay, compared to intravenous administration, I will give the same drug. In this case, I have given the drug in tablet form. Next, I will give the same drug intravenously. If I give the same drug intravenously, IV, let's say I am giving paracetamol here. First, I have given paracetamol orally. I have measured what is the systemic availability of paracetamol. Let's say that is 350 mg is available. I have given 500 mg, but only 350 mg is available. Okay, divided by, I will give the same paracetamol systemically. So, systemically I will give obviously 500 mg, that 500 mg is available, that is through IV route, intravenous. This comparison we call it as absolute bioavailability. So, absolute bioavailability means same drug, fraction you have to take. What is the amount of drug absorbed when I give orally divided by what is the amount of drug absorbed when I give IV. IV obviously it will be 100%. This comparison we call it as absolute bioavailability. Okay. So, this we call it as absolute bioavailability. Next, it is denoted by F. So F means, remember, absolute bioavailability. Okay, what is the fraction? When what is the comparison? One is oral divided by IV. Same drug, remember, same drug. Okay, oral divided by IV, we call it as absolute bioavailability. Its determination is used to characterize the drug's inherent absorption property from extravascular site. So what we are going to, why we are conducting this type of bioavailability study design, what we are studying here, study design. Why we are conducting, in the study design we have absolute bioavailability. Absolute bioavailability, why we are conducting this type of study? Because we are giving orally and systemically and testing the fraction, you will come to know, okay, in the IV it is absorbed 100%, but when I given it orally, it is absorbed only this much percent. Then we will come to know what is the inherent absorption properties of drug through extravascular. If you are given the drug extravascular, extravascular means maybe orally, topically, anyway, extravascular, okay, other than vascular. So what is that inherent property of the drug for the absorption when it is given in orally? To study, to know this one, you need to conduct absolute bioavailability study. Remember GPAT question, to know what is inherent absorption property, which type of study is been conducted. So that study is absolute bioavailability study. So what is absolute? Oral by IV of the same drug. Then intravenous dose is selected as a standard. Here in this study, in this type of study, that is your absolute bioavailability study, we consider IV of that particular drug as a standard, because obviously 100% of drug is available there, hence we consider it as standard. In case you can consider intramuscular also taken as a standard, if the drug is poorly water soluble, obviously if the drug is poorly water soluble, you won't give the drug to the IV because it will get crystallized there, then it will cause problem. In such case, you will give the drug to the intramuscular. So again, one GPAT question, which type of drug is being considered as a standard in absolute bioavailability? Okay, in absolute bioavailability, if it is given in intramuscular injection. So you can think that absolute bioavailability means I am giving oral by IV. Because the drug is insoluble, because the drug solubility is very low, we are preferring the standard route as intramuscular. If the drug is not soluble, if you give that insoluble drug into the systemic circulation, it will get crystallized, it will cause a problem. Hence we try to give the drug in muscular, remember this. So muscular dose also, intramuscular dose also be considered as a standard for conducting bioavailability design study, that is absolute bioavailability study, where the solubility of the drug is low. If the drug solubility is less, go for intramuscular as a standard. If the drug has no solubility problem, go for intravenous as a standard. Then an oral solution is reference standard, has also been used in certain cases. So in certain cases they use oral solution. Let's say I am giving tablet, in such case I will use solution of the same drug as a standard also. So there are three standards for conducting bioavailability in case of absolute bioavailability studies. What are those three standards? One is IV first, if the drug has good solubility. If the drug has not good solubility, then we go for intramuscular, that is IM. In some cases we can also consider oral solution. Here I am mentioning it is a solution. Solution means there is no dosage form. Take drug soluble in water or something, prepare solution, give to the patient. Okay, how will you conduct this absolute study for oral solution? So we will give drug in dosage form. If the drug is solid, if we give the solid, measure how much drug is entered into the systemic circulation. Then you will give oral solution, measure how much drug enter into the systemic circulation. From this study, what the thing you came to know is, what is the effect of excipient on the drug absorption also you can come to know if you conduct this, if you take oral solution as a standard. However, there are several drawbacks of using oral solution as a standard instead of IV. See, most probably we prefer only IV. In rare case, we go for oral solution. You can ask me, sir, in that case, I can directly give the oral solution. No, there is some drawbacks here. So these are the drawbacks which are there for the oral solution. So the drawbacks is, first one is, limits the pharmacokinetic treatment to one compartment model only. So the oral solution will limit the pharmacokinetic treatment to one compartment model only, because already drug is soluble, it will directly absorb. Okay, so no need of treating two compartments. If the drug is in CL, one cannot apply the most applicable two compartment kinetics to the data, and pharmacokinetic parameters cannot be assessed. So that is a problem with this. You can't assess two compartment model when you give the drug in oral solution. One. Next, differentiate between the fraction of dose unabsorbed and metabolized is very difficult. In case of oral solution, unabsorbed and metabolized, see what happens if you give the drug through orally, two things will happen. If you give 100% drug, some of the drug is absorbed, some of the drug is metabolized. So how much of the drug is absorbed, how much of the drug is metabolized, to find out this is very, very difficult if you give the drug in oral solution form. If you give the drug IV, there is no metabolism, hence it is very clear that okay, this much drug is there in the systemic circulation. If you give the drug in the, if you want to take the oral solution as a standard, then there will be differentiation problem between the metabolized drug and unabsorbed drug. Then we have, if the rate of oral absorption is not sufficiently greater than the rate of elimination, the true elimination rate constant cannot be computed. So what this point is saying is, let's say I have given the drug, just wait. Let's say I have given the drug through orally, the drug will absorb. So the rate of absorption, see here, the rate of absorption is not greater than the rate of elimination. So what I want to know is, generally what happens, slowly drug will absorb and slowly it will get eliminated. This is elimination phase, this is absorption phase. Okay, if the elimination phase is more than the absorption phase, let's say some drug is there, if the elimination phase is more than the absorption phase, what happens, as soon as the drug absorbs, it will get eliminated. As soon as the drug absorbs, it will get eliminated. In such case, true elimination rate constant can't be computed. You can't compute the true elimination rate constant. The absorption should be, the absorption rate constant should be more, Ka should be more than Ke, then only you can compute true elimination rate constant. If Ke is more than Ka, you can't compute the true elimination rate constant. Why it is happening? In case of oral, if you want to use oral solution of a drug as a standard. Okay. Yeah. Yes. So at best, when oral solution is used in conjunction with the IV route, one can distinguish the dissolution rate elimination in drug absorption from the solid dosage form. So what this point is saying is, what is the best use of oral solution is, one can distinguish the dissolution rate limitation. So because you are giving the drug in solution form, first you have given the drug in solid dosage form, now the same drug is given in solution form. So what is the difference between solid and solution? From the solid, drug had to disintegrate and dissolute, that is dissolution. In the solution form, the drug is already in solution form, you can eliminate the dissolution parameter of the drug. That what is saying, you can distinguish the dissolution rate limitation in drug absorption from the solid dosage form. So if you want to use, I just said you, if you want to use oral solution as a standard, the use of that oral solution of a standard, where you can use that, is to know what is the dissolution limitations here. If your dissolution is the rate limiting step for the drug absorption, this can be identified if you use oral solution of a drug as a standard. Then another type of study is there. I just said you there are two type of study design. One is your absolute bioavailability. Second type of study design is when the systemic availability of drug after oral administration is compared with that of an oral standard of the same drug. Okay, so same thing, you are given the drug orally in solid dosage form, then you are given the drug systemically, you are given the drug orally, same orally in solution form. We call the solution form as standard. See here, such as aqueous or non-aqueous solution or suspension. When you compare this bioavailability, when you compare the systemic availability of a drug from a solid dosage form and same drug from a solution or suspension or something that is in liquid form, this type of study design we call it as relative bioavailability. What is relative? You are relating. Okay, what is the amount of drug which is absorption when you given the drug in solid dosage form to the, what is the amount of drug which is absorbed when I given the drug in the liquid dosage form? Because you are relating there, hence we speak it as a relative bioavailability. So relative means, remember, same drug solid by oral standard solution, that is aqueous or non-aqueous, or you can say suspension also. Remember, okay, GPAT question, they can give suspension also as a oral standard. In such case, we call it as relative bioavailability. It is denoted as FR. Absolute bioavailability, just F. This one, FR. This R means relative bioavailability. Okay. In contrast to the absolute bioavailability, it is used to characterize absorption of drug from formulation. Just I said you, if you use a drug in solid form and if you use a drug in solution form, obviously, to characterize what is the drug absorption from the formulation, to study what is the drug absorption from the formulation, you can go for relative bioavailability. So what is the usefulness of relative bioavailability study design in case of bioavailability is, you can characterize the absorption of drug from the formulation. Remember, to characterize absorption of drug from the formulation, which type of study has been conducted? Relative bioavailability study is conducted. Okay, generally these two, absolute and relative, is expressed in the form of percentage. How much drug is absorbed from the solid dosage form by solution into 100. So generally we denote this in percentage only. Okay, thank you.